Mr. Program Secretary, Mr. President, Mr. Dean, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's my privilege to have an opportunity to welcome all of you to our second session of the series Bridges, Dialogues Towards a Culture of Peace, being held at John Brown University. Today, on November 25th, which is known as Wachirabu Day or Manatira Nagra Day. I would like to begin our program with a welcoming speech by the President of John Brown University, Associate Professor Dr. Kachaisen.
เมื่อกี้มันมูฟต่างที่ไหมไม่นะไม่ใช่แล้วกล้องก็ไหนแชร์แมนออฟอินเตอร์เนชั่นแนลพีซฟาวเดชั่นไม่มีเขาไม่มีใส่สัญญาณอ๋อเห็นแล้วอ๋อหลายไปนู่นอ๋อหลายไปนู่น Bridges, Dialogues Towards a Culture of Peace. Our lecture today, The Role of Science and Technology in the Quest for a World of Peace, presented by Kasikorn Bank, is the second in a series of more than 100 lectures and dialogues, seminars, workshops,
and
Our speaker at this forum today, Nobel Laureate of Chemistry, Professor Jerome Carr, is joined by other Nobel Laureates in physics, chemistry, and literature, as well as decision makers in international politics, economics, science, culture, and the media. This activity was launched with the realization that we live in uncertain times and there is perhaps no worry or concern today so pressing as peace for nations, for families, and for individuals. Throughout time and history, states and societies have thought of peace in terms of the absence of war and violence, and have sought to achieve peace through largely military or defense means. It is only with the last half centuries increasing international and local initiatives towards dialogue, mediation, negotiation, recognition and accommodation from the creation of the United Nations to various peace talks and processes to settle age-old conflicts in strife-torn areas of the globe, that the world has seen clearer understanding of our common humanity and the need to reach common goals peacefully. Today, with a growing threat and vector of terrorism and the resurgence of war and militarism in foreign policy discourse and action, we have been made to revisit and rethink some of these milestones in peaceful negotiations and dialogue. We have been told that in an increasingly dangerous world, our responses must entail stronger, more forceful remedies and action. We have been made to think again about our responses in settling disputes and whether war can still be considered an instrument It is precisely for this reason that we must, now more than ever, seek the ways of peace, not just in terms of avoiding greater physical conflict, but more meaningfully in the broader sense of human security. This means not just giving our people and communities the chance to live free of chaos, but allowing them the chance to live with a sense of opportunity and hope for the future. And it's for this reason that we must return to the deeper understanding of culture and community, to appreciate difference and respect diversity within and among societies, and celebrate them. It is about being able to somehow view the world and the human condition, difficult as this may sound, from the perspective of those we may be
involved
with. It is about convergence, not control, of humility, not hubris. It is about embracing the basic truth that all cultures seek a sense of security and continuity, a living link between history, ancestry, and the past, and the future which will be held and equipped to succeed in human beings. We must, as I said, one said, never tire of the ways of peace, even in the face of destruction and death. It is a twin challenge that peace and culture. Together, they must be for us the fabric of community which every society deserves, rich, creative and evolving. In fact, we should consider, if I may take the liberty of borrowing from the title of our esteemed lecturer today, the role of dialogue in the quest for a world at peace.
ซึ่งตามโครงการที่ผู้ได้รับรางวัลประสาทต่างๆจำนวน22ท่านมาบรรยายกระแสการปฏิบัติตลอดระยะเวลา2ปีนับจากนี้การที่มูลนิธิสันติภาพมหาชาติซึ่งเป็นองค์กรที่ส่งเสริมกิจกรรมสื่อสารสันติภาพในเรื่องประเทศไทยเป็นที่ชุมนุมแห่งปราศจากทั่วโลกเชิญผู้ได้รับรางวัลโนเบลสาขาต่างๆมาบรรยายและแสดงการปฏิบัติภายใต้โครงการสารสัมพันธ์สื่อสันติวัฒนธรรมย่อมเป็นการแสดงให้เป็นที่ประจักษ์แก่นานาประเทศว่าประเทศไทยเป็นดินแดนที่มีความสงบสันติสุขอย่างแท้จริงเพื่อร่วมภาคภูมิใจในเกียรติภูมิของประเทศธนาคารกสิกรไทยหวังเป็นอย่างยิ่งว่าการบรรยายพิเศษในวันนี้จะเป็นประโยชน์แก่ผู้เข้าร่วมฟังการบรรยายท่านขอบคุณครับ
เพื่อเป็นเกียรติกับโฮสเตอร์จากสุขภาพ
This is our first call now. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the Ministry of Science and Technology, it is my privilege and pleasure to welcome Professor Joseph Carr, 1985 Nobel Laureate for Chemistry, and all the participants attending the second seminar in the series which dialogues toward the culture of peace today. On this day, not only you will enjoy the opportunity to welcome the distinguished 1985 Nobel Laureate to our country, but we also cherish the opportunity to our fellow Thai scientists and educators from various institutions and schools to have a chance to be inspired by the reflections and insights of our world-class scientists who have spent his entire career contributing tirelessly to the progress and development in science. His lecture today will focus on the influences of science and technology on the quality of life, global environment, natural resources, world economies, and more. The lecture will also stress on how individual scientists and societies alike can head toward a deep and ongoing dialogue toward a culture of peace. Therefore, I would like to take this opportunity to open the second seminar in the series which dialogues toward a culture of peace, entitled The Law of Science and Technology in the Quest for World Peace. May I wish Professor Carr a pleasant stay in Thailand and success in all his endeavors for protecting the valuable resources and population of this planet and thereby generating world peace. Thank you very much.
The advances in health, comfort,
convenience, and personal well-being are most evident. Despite these inspiring accomplishments, the future is more and more threatened with the deterioration of the quality of life and the proliferation of social inequities. It is therefore imperative that societies make planning for the future a high priority consideration. Appreciation of the need is increasing, having become much more widespread in recent years as people find the various manifestations of the pressing problems part of their own life experiences. In looking toward the future, it is incumbent on us to consider our past and present circumstances in order to establish key issues, priorities, and necessary action. In this way, the impact of the threats may be minimized, and cultural, ethical, and humane values may not only prevail, but even be enhanced. Many individuals and organizations have already devoted much effort to these questions. Much still needs to be done by bringing societies and governments into effective action. It is my intention here to present some impressions obtained from a number of the studies that have already been made, while emphasizing the degree to which many of the current and potential problems are interconnected. The objective is to identify major factors that contribute to or generate the conditions that threaten our planet. Such factors must be controlled so that their harmful effects may be minimized or reversed. Failure to do so could lead to great harm to the Earth and life upon it. When we think of problem areas, we think of the environment, of human violence and warfare, of the many failings of human character, of the failings of leadership, of the interactions of economics, population, and human psychology, of health, the food supply, and we wonder about the extent to which many of these problems are interconnected and whether the interconnections can be sorted out so that there may be some hope of dealing with the problems effectively. And finally, much discussion has been in the literature of organizations dedicated to preserving a healthful and humane environment, which concerns the many human activities that have severely degraded the environment. These activities threaten the habitability of major portions of the Earth and perhaps all of them. How far do we have to look to find examples? Polluted air, waterways and oceans, ravaged lands, erosion, desertification, deforestation, and radioactive and chemical wastes are by now either common experience or common knowledge. Even the more esoteric threats, which may not be as broadly appreciated or sensed, such as the depletion of the ozone layer and the accumulation of hot house gases, have been brought to our attention. At which point does the damage become irreversible? How great an insult can the Earth take and still bounce back? Have we passed the point of no return with some of these issues? Possibly, probably not. It would be prudent, nevertheless, to take immediate steps to minimize the effects of the various threats. This requires no less than world cooperation among societies as well as their governments. Can this be achieved? There is another aspect of a proper environment that is important to consider, namely quality of life. This means various things to various people, but it may be broadly described as an aspect of life that goes beyond the minimum requirements of subsistence, shelter, and basic health needs. For many of us, quality of life involves artistic, aesthetic, and intellectual components, human decency,
high standards of behavior, peace, trust, kindly interaction among people, with respect to human dignity and sufficient space in which to dwell. The amount of space for comfort may vary considerably among us, but I believe that most of us need room for privacy, thought, and contemplation. This is not to be found readily in congested cities and congested living conditions brought on by a high-density population. High-density population impacts profoundly on the environment and all aspects of the quality of life. It is difficult to imagine an environmental problem that would not be improved by a decreasing population and made worse by an increase. Since the current trend is manifested by an explosion of population in many parts of the world, it is clear that this factor in environmental problems demands immediate attention. The exceedingly hot temperatures experienced in Europe this past summer may well have been a manifestation of global warming. If so, we have a clear example of one of the many serious consequences of ignoring the advice coming from scientific and other technical groups. Nature's storehouse. There are many reasons for not destroying huge ecological areas such as rainforests. The main one is that such areas are vast biological storehouses of substances having important potential to benefit humans. This derives from the fact that living organisms, including both flora and fauna, develop chemical mechanisms that protect them from hostile environments, predators, infectious agents, and disease. Such problems happen inside the nature in a great variety of ways, most of which are yet to be discovered. The compounds involved can possibly serve humanity in many ways, as antibiotics, insecticides, herbicides, fungicides, preservatives, drugs such as anti-cancer agents and anti-malarials, hot drugs, and many other types of physiologically active substances. Destruction of ecological systems destroys the opportunity to learn the secrets forever. Economics and war. The Earth is finite, and the number of people whom the Earth can support is finite under the best of circumstances. As a consequence, people have developed concepts of a sustainable economy and a sustainable Earth. Rarely is the expression sustainable economy heard. The term economic growth predominates. Certainly, activities that replace other ones can grow, and to an extent, new activities can grow. Growth can also be associated with the rising of the average quality of life in the world. There are limits, however, and the limits arise limits on natural resources, limits on need and demand, limits generated by environmental considerations and constraints on the total population. The latter statement provides a clear indication that future economic policy must be in harmony with the finiteness of resources and population and the requirements of a wholesome environment. Economic competition is often enhanced by limited resources and markets. In the extreme case, it leads to warfare. A major component of many wars has been economic competition. There have been, of course, additional issues, but it seems fair to say that economic motivation has predominated. Economic competition should not be expected to cease when warfare ceases. Experience in the post-war World War II period, for example, is testimony to the fact that its underlying aspects of economic competition never disappeared, but simply has taken on another form. If and when the major players in the industrialized states decide to confront economic reality by supporting and developing their human humane and industrial capacities consistent with the broader concepts of sustainability and a large measure of self-sufficiency, they may be able to save their countries and future generations from severe economic hardship, if not destruction. There's not much to say about war per se. It is enormously destructive. It dehumanizes and brutalizes the survivors, damages the environment, wastes resources, and may leave legacies of great potential harm to future generations. Nevertheless, warfare has been all too a common phenomenon in this past century. Societies must find other ways that are non-violent to deal with their economic stresses and other procedural problems. Separate foreign arms into those societies that are most likely to use them offensively does not help matters. The large and apparently irresistible profit motive in the selling of arms makes control very difficult. The economic gain may be short-range, but the harm can be major and long-lasting. There is not likely to be a net gain for any society in the long run. There are other circumstances in which perceived short-term economic gains motivate inappropriate behavior and result in net economic loss and harm to society. Industrial pollution is an example. Pollution often occurs because industry makes short-range economic decisions or because appropriate legal regulations are not in place or are not enforced. I've made a point of this to emphasize that economic and environmental problems require clear thought on the part of all concerned. The problems that threaten the world involve everyone. Solutions to the problems may require extra effort, but the implementation of the solutions involves us all. Societies and governments must be strongly involved and come together. Gainful employment in the age of automation. I recall reading an article several years ago that characterized the present economic dilemma, namely that a new revolution is taking place in manufacturing without being accompanied by a subsequent reduction in working. A main generator of this revolution is automation with its accompanying efficiency. The authors say that this is the first time a major manufacturing advance in efficiency was not followed by a reduction in the workers. The consequence of the circumstance is that advanced societies are becoming remarkably incapable of providing meaningful employment for a large fraction of its citizens. Expanding populations can certainly add to the problem. In the present economic climate, many of our countries, the industrial response to monetary problems is to dismiss large numbers of employees and overwork others. This does not lead to economic stability for society as a whole. Manufacturers must also be prepared to anticipate rather than supply, simply respond to dwindling supplies of raw materials and rapidly changing markets. It would be most appropriate for society to analyze the social and economic implications of the rapidly developing technologies, changing markets, and the world economy, and other powerful forces that affect the quality of life in their communities. The problems are not insoluble. It would seem that successful societies would need to have a sustainable plan in which all the population would have the opportunity to make a contribution and thereby earn enough compensation to enjoy what most people would recognize as a decent standard can this be achieved in the atmosphere of competition that has characterized the industrial revolution up to this time? It is possible to achieve sustainable autonomy and decent living standards without inhibiting the various aspects of individual initiative and creativity. There are myriad of questions that society is making sense. The world, however, cannot possibly benefit from continued procrastination in facing these issues or wait for the results of endless debate and deliberation. Too much debate and little testing is as bad for societies as it is for science. What would need to be done, were governments willing, would be to take a careful look at resources, human and otherwise, set goals on the basis of high and presumably workable ideals and implement them. There would be the need for flexibility so that in learning from experience, corrections could be made in a stepwise process. This would require governments to be composed of people or advised by people with the highest intelligence and personal standards and whose greatest satisfaction would derive from the good results that they could achieve. This is not as difficult to secure as may seem. There are many such people. The important step is for governments to be open to accepting well-motivated, well-thought-out plans and make difficult, selfless decisions for the good of society, unencumbered by political consideration. A view of the history of the 20th century suggests that the world is more than ready, but ill prepared for such high-minded developments. That certainly seems to be broadly true. Nevertheless, there are a few countries that have renounced war and appear to have pursued for long periods steps towards a human society. I'm happy to say that my short experience here indicates that Thailand is one of those countries. Ethics and education. It is important that young people be trained from an early age to question contemporary concepts and ideas that swirl around them. Together with this, they should be taught how to think and draw rational conclusions. Together with this, the development of high standards should come from the home as well as the school. If they do not come from the home, they must come from the school. The learning of purely factual material, of course, is indispensable, but education obtained in the absence of fine-tuned reasoning and ethical sensitivity is probably a major contributor to social, societal issues. Valuable leadership qualities are the ability to apply sound intellectuality to problems and to use the results in an ethical fashion. It is to be expected that an educational system that emphasizes such qualities in general would raise the standards and quality of life for society as a whole. In addition to learning how to think, a very worthwhile feature of an educational system is for it to be broadly based. Perhaps we may hope that in the future, training in graduate institutions will be prerequisite to the appointment of high political office, and that the entering students will be among the finest graduates of an educational system that promotes broad scholarship combined with ethical principles. The world can always benefit from great leaders with impeccable standards, having raw intellectuality and a good sense of what may be achieved in practice. Character. We are told by behavioral scholars that it is important to start to instill character into children at a very young age. Otherwise, in general, it becomes much more difficult. This appears to be a subject that merits careful consideration, since it seems to be vital for the achievement of more humane and ethical societies in the future. In addition to building character, it is important to teach young people to have inquiring minds and well-ordered priorities. They must learn to think, gather information, and draw rational indispensables, population control is an indispensable. I'm in agreement with many others who have indicated that unless population is brought under control, it will not be possible to enhance the human condition on a broad scale. Any progress will be eliminated by huge numbers of people who must be supported as the unbridled increase in overall population persists. Population control must be achieved. The second indispensable is sustainability. The control of sustainability must be brought to the handling of environmental problems. Activities that degrade the environment can no longer be tolerated. Renewable energy sources, for example, must replace the burning of fossil fuels. Economic decisions impact greatly on the sustainability of the environment, and in fact on the viability and sustainability of the economy. It was pointed out in a talk that I read some time ago that the inhabitants of Easter Island, located on the west coast of South America, used up all the resources of the island to the extent that they did not have enough food to be successful and did not have enough wood to build boats on which to escape from the island. Proper human behavior is indispensable. The amount of animosity in various groups put their neighbors in many areas of the world with serious impairment to progress. The easement of seeing the culture of society can be transformed to behave in a barbaric fashion is another sad lesson in the 20th century. Such threats of unbridled hostility and violence must be prepared if the proper environment for peace and stability is to be achieved. Barriers. There are various barriers that can interfere with the broad attainment of equality in existence. The problems that need to be overcome are formidable. They are manifold and extensive. Great leadership in the world is required to overcome societal ignorance, selfish motives, lack of character, diverse priorities, and values widespread, unwholesome lifestyles. Violence and the lack of suitable mechanisms to settle disputes principally, exploitation in the earth by people and the population is global at large. Societies whose survival is largely cannot really give much attention to the issues that are raised in this presentation. It is very difficult for societies or individuals on the edge of survival to change the patterns of their lives. Many marginal societies are overpopulated. Agriculture of the ozone layer in the atmosphere. have a strong effect on the ability of countries to address the many problems that are facing them in the near future, and even the present. I'll close my remarks by simply saying that I am a member of the scientific organization, which is interested in trying to make the world a better place. I came from a meeting a month ago at which there were representatives from organizations, scientific organizations, that have over 12 million people as members. I'm also aware of some other scientific organizations that have become interested in the problems that I was talking about.
ล็อกขาเนี่ยเกตพี่ที่บ่าหมุนไม่ออกเลยอ่ะพี่จะปรับลงไง
We can't blame the free branch for being used that way, and we can't again, and I was silenced for giving this news. So I'm sorry to take the giving of this thing.
Dr. Carl, for your insightfulness and being here with us to share your experience. My name is Gerald Thompson, and one of the main topics that you continue to address was the population control. And I'm wondering if you had a comment on, as you said, the misuse and abuse of science, if we also, in the allocation of our resources, if that misuse of resources is not the major problem rather than an excess of people on this planet. And I've heard, and I don't know how to check it, but that mathematically, the total number of people now alive on the planet equals the sum total of all the people who have ever lived here. And this is very interesting because it means we're all here now, and we're all living in the consequences of what we've done and what we haven't done with our technology and our resources, and it may be time for us to really wake up. Each able-bodied person only working 3 days a year if we efficiently utilize the technology and resources available to us at this time. Actually, this was nearly 20 years ago, so it's probably 2 days now. Any comment?
Yes, I agree. That's
I was just wondering if you could clarify your definition of sustainability. I'm over here. I was thinking, no matter what we do in the world, we're always using energy and transforming that energy into unusable entropy. You know, if you, no matter if you drive somewhere or walk somewhere, you're always taking something that's usable and turning it into something that isn't usable. And I'm wondering, where exactly do we draw the line between unsustainability and sustainability if everything in the end is going to lead to this, I guess, heat death or whatever, I'm not sure what they call it, or it's going to lead to the you know, the using up of everything, of all our resources?
That's a very good question. However, fortunately, there are some outside resources. So far as energy is concerned. And we have to learn how to make use of it better. For example, the sun.
But
the sun doesn't give you enough energy to make it on the planet.
สำหรับท่านผู้ช่วงรายการวันนี้ทุกท่านนะคะ ชิญชมนิทรรศการที่จะแสดงภายนอกนะคะซึ่งเป็นนิทรรศการแสดงถึงคณะวิจัยของวิศวกรรมแล้วก็คณะวิจัยคณะวิทยาศาสตร์จุฬาลงกรณ์มหาวิทยาลัยสำหรับท่าน